Today, I'll give you my own impressions of the Dream Air, which I recently tested back at the Pimax headquarters. How well does it perform in VR games and simulators, being Pimax's first small form factor VR headset, and most importantly, is it really better than the Crystal Super? Well, let's find out. First off, what you see here is an in-house prototype sample of the Dream Air. Or you can clearly tell there are two versions of what I'm showing here. That fancy-looking Dream Air sample gives you a sneak peek of how the final unit will look like. In fact, this is not a dummy, it's a fully equipped and operating sample. But at the time of me testing, I was only allowed to use that other sample, which is the same headset, the same components, the same optical engine, same functionality, but with some minor design changes. Since the self-tensioning strap is still in development, this Dream Air sample is attached to a temporary, pretty familiar-looking head strap. Yes, this is a DAS, and this is not how the Dream Air will look like when shipped to customers. It's also connected to the PC with the standard DisplayPort cable from the Crystal Super, which also is a temporary solution. So again, have that in mind, this is a temporary Dream Air setup, while this is a visually something more close to the final product. Having said that, for this video, I don't want to judge the physical aspects of the Dream Air samples here, such as the total weight, the comfort, or the design. Instead, I'm here to simply test how this tiny little thing performs in terms of visual quality, the optics, the displays, and its features. We already know that the Dream Air houses two Sony Micro OLED panels with the resolution of 3840 by 3552 pixels per eye or per panel. We also know that the entire optical engine of the Dream Air, which includes the panels and the concave view lenses, are more or less identical to the Crystal Super Micro OLED optical engine I tested in my previous video. Due to the small form factor size of the Dream Air, the alignment of the optical engine is slightly adjusted in comparison to how it's fitted on the Crystal Super. Obviously, because we're dealing with much smaller headset here, having less space to work with. This doesn't affect the image quality at all, but it does affect the maximum field of view we can expect from Dream Air compared to the Crystal Super Micro OLED. So just like we did last time, let's start off with the field of view. Using a test HMD application as always, the horizontal field of view I got was around 110 degrees. Thanks to those concave view lenses, we are achieving a slightly wider field of view than what was officially stated when Dream Air was first announced roughly a year ago. The vertical field of view is identical to what Crystal Super Micro OLED optical engine can do, which is 88 degrees. But you have probably heard this already, since MRTV Sebastian recently published a couple of videos about his Dream Air impressions.
This was truly the best visuals I've seen in VR so far. And I don't say this lightly because I have all the headset, everything. So like this, because of the FOV, it wins against my until now favorite, the Mega Nex. Like I would say same clarity, but better FOV, a little bit less monocular overlap, but only so little difference that this is still incredible.
If you have seen his videos, then you also know that during his short stay at the headquarters, which was my last day before leaving home to Sweden, we both also tested a couple of new and different distortion profiles for Dream Air. These profiles allowed for a wider field of view, not only horizontally, but also vertically. Horizontally, I saw something between 112 and 114 degrees on the Dream Air, and the vertical field of view was up in between 94 and 96 degrees.
Wow, yeah. This is the experience I want, you know, with that nice binocular overlap, but it's still a big FOV. Yeah, this is it.
Meanwhile, the binocular overlap was even bigger with this new profile. And I know this is almost a bit weird. It shouldn't be possible, right? It's kind of Himax Blackmagic, because the binocular overlap was almost 83 degrees with the main profile I tested at first, but with the improved distortion profile, we both saw RISA 2000, the HMDQ tool, report almost 93 degrees of binocular overlap, despite that wider field of view already. And I especially remember Sebastian saying he loved that stereo overlap, making it more comfortable for his eyes, and I do agree here. I wasn't recording anything on my last day of the trip when Sebastian was with me, so I cannot give you any proof of that on video, but I can assure you that the numbers I recorded here are far from final, and the field of view values and that binocular overlap will positively surprise you once the Dreamer starts shipping. I also said it in my last video, I personally think that the binocular overlap on this micro OLED optical engine is the best I've ever seen on a Pimax headset. As for general image quality, it's literally identical to the Crystal Super Micro OLED I tested last time in basically all aspects. The crazy high resolution of the Dreamer being 3840 by 3552 pixels per panel or per eye is in fact a bit lower on the total amount of pixels compared to what the Crystal Super QLED panel offers, 3840 by 3840 per eye. But despite that, the micro OLED image is definitely sharper and produces a better clarity overall. I mentioned this previously, but there's just something about these micro OLED optical engines that renders a very stable, extremely sharp VR image with almost no aliasing or shimmering at all. It just looks clean somehow. I do suspect it's because the Sony panels have a pixel density or a pixel fill factor that is higher or better than the Crystal Super with the standard 50 ppd module. What I didn't mention last time is that the official PPD or pixel per degree value of that micro OLED optical engine now has been calculated and officially stated to be 53 PPD. Maybe there is more into it, or maybe it's because of the concave view lenses, who knows, but I really really like what I see here. And not only is the center part of the view super sharp, but it's the same sharpness almost all the way to the edges when reading text or looking at test charts. The sweet spot is just phenomenal, making it very easy to adjust the headset to my eyes. Small misalignments on the headset will simply not affect your view in VR, I think. Again, this not only improves general usability, but also makes it extremely easy for me to record all these through-the-lens videos and photos you see throughout this video using just my smartphone. So a super sharp and stable image with a big sweet spot. Now add the fact that Mura is literally non-existent on these micro OLED panels. Yes, zero Mura. It cannot get cleaner than this, I think, when looking up in the bright sky when doing flight simulators or just staring at the sky in the SteamVR home environment like I used to do for some reason. I may repeat myself here again, but also the chromatic aberration is minimal and can only be spotted at very far peripheral view. I would claim that I see absolutely no chromatic aberration within the binocular overlap area. This is a huge improvement over what we've seen on the Crystal Light and the Crystal Super that uses aspheric lenses and the QLED panels. Blare and God rays are also on minimal levels here, just like with the Super Micro OLED optical engine I tested last time. It's not completely gone, but I think it's as good as it can get on a VR headset with pancake lenses. In games and simulators, I could not really see any glare. In SteamVR Home glare test, you can spot some minor glare if you look for it, but it's something most people won't even notice, I think. Then of course the black levels stay true black without crashing details in dark scenes. The sky really looks like a pitch black night sky when flying DCS World or playing any dark VR game. I would say OLED or micro OLED is unique when it comes to this, having the ability to completely turn off and on each individual pixel on the panel. The average brightness and especially peak brightness levels will never reach what we can achieve with the Crystal Light, or especially the Crystal Super with aspheric glass lenses. but it's totally acceptable brightness. At least just as good as any other small form factor a competitor has, if not better. What also is familiar is the render resolutions and the better performance you get with Micro OLED. At Pimax Play image quality set to 1.0, using the same distortion profile I'm basing this video on, DreamAir currently renders a resolution of 4980 by 3992 pixels per eye. This is way lower resolution compared to what the Super 50 PPD module requires at the same settings. That's all thanks to a more efficient distortion profile, using much less extra pixels to correct potential edge distortions. And this means DreamAir not only gives us better sharpness and clarity than the Super 50 PPD module, but also more headroom for potentially much better performance in any VR game or simulator you may play. At Pimax render quality set to 0.75, which still looks really great on the DreamAir, a render resolution of only 3732 by 2992 pixels per eye is needed. That potentially gives us crystal light frame rate performance in games and simulators, but with a much higher pixel density, sharpness, and better clarity, of course. So what I'm trying to say here is that if you already have a Crystal Light or the original Crystal, you definitely do not need a new GPU or graphics card when upgrading to the DreamAir or the Crystal Super with Micro OLED. You can potentially get even better performance than before. Well, if you're lucky and have an RTX 5090, maybe you want to overkill the clarity and sharpness like VR Flight Sim guy Steve used to do, I can tell you that the Pimax Play image quality set to 1.25 only renders a resolution of 6204 by 4972 pixels per eye. That is still a lower total resolution compared to what the Crystal Super 50 PPD module requires at image quality even set to 1.0. This is huge, I would say, especially for people like me, which are still, you know, stuck with the 4090 GPU or much lower. And I could indeed see better frame rates running, especially DCS World with the DreamAir compared to my Crystal Super 50 PPD frame rates. And yes, DreamAir also supports AMD GPUs, just like the Crystal Super does, while other small form factor headsets might not do. The DreamAir runs on default in 90Hz using native resolution, so no upscaling or any compromises at 90Hz. Additionally, a 72Hz mode is available already now. As for the other built-in components and features, Tobii eye tracking with its camera and sensors are already built in around that concave view lenses, but they're still not enabled with software yet, so I couldn't test eye tracking or DFR. There is motorized IPD on DreamAir, and it is working now and it can be adjusted from the Pimax Play. But once the eye tracking is enabled, we will also have auto IPD available. Audio is going to be integrated into the final strap, so as of now, no comments on the audio. The current DreamAir I was testing utilized SteamVR or a Lighthouse 6 degree of freedom tracking using at least one or two base stations and any Lighthouse compatible controller such as the Valve Index Knuckles or the Pimax Sword. Tracking was just flawless and there's not much to be said here really. There will also be a SLAM-tracked version of the DreamAir supporting inside-out tracking with cameras, which will be released a bit later. So, to briefly sum this up, in my opinion, the DreamAir delivers identical image quality, clarity, sharpness, and a VR experience overall when compared to the Crystal Super Micro OLED optical engine. Apart from a few degrees of field of view less, it is exactly the same experience. And it's totally a better VR experience compared to the 50 PPD Crystal Super in terms of image quality overall. But is it in any way better than the Crystal Super Micro OLED? I really don't think so. Sure, it's a considerably cooler looking, smaller and lighter headset for those who prefer this form factor. To me, I would say I feel more comfortable with the Super and the Micro OLED optical engine. especially since the temporary strap solution on this Dreamer, also the face mask, isn't really optimal for my face. So as of now, I would say Crystal Super Micro OLED just feels better on my face and my head. I'm sure Pimax will optimize the comfort of the Dreamer upon final release, but does it make it for a better VR headset though? I really don't know. So I'm gonna be totally honest here, saying that if you already have a Crystal Super, I would say just go for the Super Micro OLED module. It's gonna end up cheaper for you as an upgrade, but you will get the same VR experience and can meanwhile still use your other optical engines like the ultra wide or the 57 PPD module, which I still think is the sharpest of them all. But that's just me, I guess. How about you then? Are you going for the Dreamer or the Micro OLED optical engine for the Crystal Super? Let us know in the comments. That's all for this time. Thank you for watching and see you in the next one.